The following program is made possible by Wells Fargo. Wells Fargo, the next stage.
In San Mateo County's 2015 vote-by-mail election, more voters turned out than in any recent election of its kind.
Does that mean it was a success? The game is election innovation. The game is on.
I'm Kevin Mullen.
And I'm Mark Simon. Welcome to the game.
San Mateo County voters appear to have liked the county's first all vote-by-mail election, which took place in November. Turnout was up overall, and in some important categories, younger voters and minority voters, participation was at an all-time high for a completely local election.
But there are some who say the election could have been better managed and was flawed, and the turnout could have even been higher. We discussed all this and more with our guest, Professor Melissa Michelson, who is a political science professor from Menlo College. Dr. Michelson also has a contract with the county to provide an analysis of the election and how it was conducted, part of the post-election assessment that will help determine whether vote-by-mail elections will spread. Welcome. Thank you for being here.
Thanks.
Turnout was up. Most people would count that as a success. It was up about 4% over a typical election of its kind. How much do you think the fact that it was an all vote by mail or virtually all vote by mail election contributed to the turnout?
It's too early to say whether it was because it was a switch to vote by mail. I think there are a couple of important things to keep in mind. One is that it wasn't really all vote by mail because there were universal polling places. And those are different than regular polling places because instead of having to go to the one that you're assigned to based on your household of where you live, you could go to any of the 32 universal polling places in the county.
So voting was more convenient even for those who voted at the polls.
Exactly. And so maybe where you work isn't where you live, but it's somewhere else in the county. You could go on your lunch break and vote. And so convenience was increased by making it vote by mail, but convenience was also increased by adding the universal polling places. In addition, the county went to extreme measures to make sure everyone knew, hey, this election is different. It's vote by mail, there's universal polling places, pay attention to the change. But that basically amounted to advertising like, hey, an election's coming up. And in a local election, a lot of people don't even realize. You know, folks are busy with their work, with their kids, with their families. And in a local election, the salience is so low, people just forget that it's time to vote. And so they got all these reminders from the media, from Mark Church's office saying, hey, there's an election. And so there was more attention being paid, and it was more convenient.
So there was just a higher level of promotion of the election.
Yeah.
So it'd be an interesting question whether or not how that would have impacted the election if it wasn't vote by mail.
Right. So we have no way of knowing if the elections office had just done all that promotion but hadn't changed how the election was conducted, turnout might have increased 4%. We don't know.
So just a quick comment on that, since we're talking about this area of costs and promotion. There is a cost savings with going to the universal polling place model, the 32, I think the number was, as opposed to the 200 something neighborhood polling places. So the savings there, some of that was used to do the promotion. I guess my hope would be is that continues in 2017, the next time we do a vote-by-mail election. But you're right, it's difficult to control for that, the promotion aspect, the mailings that were, multilingual, and the candidates themselves were promoting the fact that this was a different kind of election, which, as somebody who is associated with this effort, I certainly welcome that. I think we need to be promoting the fact that an election is coming up, these lower profile municipal elections. But it's really an issue of, I think, the cost savings being devoted to promotion. You've seen a spike sort of across the board in participation, which...
And we should, for the sake of full disclosure, note that Kevin and the Assembly carried the legislation that established this pilot program. It'll happen again in 17 and again in 19 as well? Or?
It'll just be 2017. The pilot project itself sunsets in 2018. Our next bite at the apple may be our only bite at the apple until the measure sunsets. The question at that point will be is, when you look at both election cycles, will it be deemed a success? Will it be deemed a model for the state? I certainly hope so. Of course, I'm biased. Then the issue is, do we extend this program for San Mateo County? But there are lots of changes afoot in the elections administration world in the state. So it's sort of an open question.
Because I asked you if you thought turnout was up because of this, and it's too soon to say. Is it too soon to say that it's okay to keep doing these, that it worked in terms of its funding?
It definitely worked, and I don't have the cost estimates yet, but for sure it was less expensive, because going from 209 local polling places to 32 universal polling places, that's got to save a lot of money. But part of the reason that I'm sure that it worked is because in other states, this works. If you make voting more convenient, if you have these voting centers on election day, people are more likely to turn out. If you make voting more convenient, lower turnout voters, people of color and youth are more likely to vote. And so, yeah, we can say, well, we're not sure because there's this, you know, added complication of the added promotion, but that making the election more convenient, increased turnout, would be very consistent with prior scholarship.
You know, you mentioned the cost a couple of times, and certainly everybody is interested in government saving money, but is that really, isn't the reason we should be doing this is that more people vote? I mean, isn't the fundamental reason for doing it is to get more voters to the polls? And if it was more expensive, wouldn't that even be justified as long as it got more people to the polls?
You can't not consider cost, okay, right? Everybody is concerned about cost. And yes, of course, the ideal should be that we maximize turnout. And I'm a big fan of voter turnout. It's what I've been studying for decades. But I think we can't ignore how much these things cost. So this is kind of a double winner, right? Yeah. Increased turnout and less expensive, everybody wins.
We do have Paul Mitchell, a friend of ours, did some preliminary sort of snap data analysis, and we have a chart on the traditional all-male election compared to, shows age demographics, it shows turnouts in virtually every category are up. Mm-hmm. Across the board in terms of ages, and in particular among younger voters, which is a category that historically hardly ever votes. And we were talking about off the air, they don't vote because their stake in the community is diminished compared to other people. Again, we're asking you to analyze data that's not yours. But are you surprised that that's happened, that younger voters find this a more appealing way to vote?
No, because again, the other research in Colorado, in Texas, and other elections, they've shown that if you make elections more convenient, young people are particularly more likely to participate, right? And young people are the ones who say, like, why can't we vote on our phones? Why can't we vote on the internet? A lot of them have absorbed the message, like, you should vote, it's your social duty. But, oh my gosh, really? I have to go somewhere? I have to wait in line? That's not how young people want to do it. They want to do it easily, right? So since you can't vote on the internet and you can't vote with your cell phone, voting by mail, that's a lot more convenient, and that's going to get them to participate.
And I'm curious what the impact of the postage paid, even though it's a minor little tweak, mm-hmm. that might be just enough to encourage people to go slip it in with their bills that they're going to mail. But young people in particular, did that help move the needle at all there? So you mentioned Colorado. The state is really looking at Colorado, the hybrid model, mm-hmm. Which is working by all accounts, which is the automatic receipt of a ballot at home, and then the universal high-tech polling places. Mm-hmm. And I think we as a state are going there. The question is, will Los Angeles County, some of the other large counties, embrace that? I think we're moving in that direction, but you know, San Mateo can be a model there. And just wanted to ask you about the additional permanent absentee voter signups. I guess there were about 10,000 additional folks signing up as permanent absentee voters as a result of this. Does that mean those folks are more inclined to vote going forward if they become permanent absentee voters, those 10,000?
Yeah, we have a lot of research showing that permanent absentee voters are more likely to vote. So that we've had these 10,000 people, additional people sign up to be permanent absentee means even in a non-special election where it's all vote by mail, those individuals are now going to be more likely to vote.
Is that because the act of signing up to be a permanent is a more affirmative act? In other words, they're committing to doing something versus the sort of casual approach to going to a polling place?
They've made a commitment in a way, and it's also because now they're kind of putting into place that convenience that mm-hmm. the ballot's going to come to them. And so they'll get the reminder because the ballot comes, and that reminds them that they basically made a commitment to participate by showing up. I want to add that, of course, the postage...
Let me stop you there. You can add that after a break.
Okay.
We're going to take a quick break. Stay with us. We'll be right back.
It's been over 150 years since Wells Fargo first opened for business. Since then, we've enjoyed your community support, and we're passionate about returning it. Every day, Wells Fargo team members roll up their sleeves and donate their time to organizations and charitable groups throughout the Bay Area. Nationally, we've committed even more. In just the past 2 years alone, we've donated over $70 million to support schools and educational programs. It's a commitment we're proud of. Wells Fargo, the next stage.
Talking about our historic 2015 nearly all vote by mail election with Professor Melissa Michelson from Menlo College, who's an expert in this stuff. And you wanted to respond to Kevin's comments about the free postage that it was.
Sure, because you were asking how important is that it was postage paid? Because usually when you're a permanent absentee voter, the ballot does come to you, but you have to put a stamp on. And that's another thing about young people today, and really all people today, no one's got stamps anymore, right? So if you have to get a stamp, sorry.
I still pay my bills, my check, and I send a mail stamp.
Really?
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
I don't trust anybody, frankly.
A number of people are no longer doing that. So if you don't have stamps in the house, and the ballot comes, and you have that feeling like, yeah, I want to vote, okay, oh, crap, I need a stamp? Yeah. And that just puts in a roadblock, and next thing you know, it got covered up by today's junk mail, and it's lost, and you forget to vote. So it comes in the post with the postage paid return envelope, no problem. You fill it out, you seal it, and you're good to go. So I'm sure that makes a difference.
Now, we did see, we talked earlier about the chart that showed the bump in younger voters. We have another chart that shows among Asian and Latino voters, and Bridget, if you could put that up while we talk about it. It's... shows a really substantial jump in those kinds of voters as well. And that's sociologically significant because, especially among Latino voters, all of us in California have been waiting generations for that block of voters to begin to show up. Mm-hmm. Why do you think that this had a particular appeal among minority voters, including categories where they historically don't turn out?
Well, Latinos and Asians tend not to be permanent absentee voters. And so they've always had to go to the polling places. And so for them, that it's coming to them, again, it's increasing convenience and reminding them to participate. There's also a lot of research, a lot of my research and other people's research that shows that in these communities of color, reminding them that an election is coming up and saying like, hey, this election is about you too. This election is about your community. You're included in the electorate and we want you to vote makes a huge difference. And so that they're getting reminders to vote from the elections office, that they're hearing in their mailboxes that they should be voting would logically increase turnout. Again, even in a non-all vote by mail election, that they were getting these personal reminders from the government like, hey, you, I want you to vote. And so kind of everything went right in terms of getting Latinos and Asians to participate.
So you were hired by the county to do a survey, like an exit survey of voters. Can you just give us a flavor? I know the data is still being tabulated, but just a flavor of what kinds of questions you asked, what you're looking for as you kind of drill down into the thought process and the behavior of the voters here in San Mateo County. What are you looking for?
Sure. So we've got the quantitative data, right? We've got the numbers. but we also want to know, well, how do people feel about it? Did they like having a all-mail ballot election? Did they feel that the process was secure? Do they approve? Are they worried about it? So we ask them, do you trust the Postal Service to deliver your ballots? Do you miss the social aspect of voting? Are you worried about voter fraud? Do you think this helps one or more of the political parties? And then we ask them demographic questions, including what ethno-racial group they belong to, whether they're a member of the disability community. We want to see if there's variation in terms of how people felt about it, right? So for example, maybe members of the disability community are going to be less happy about the switch because it means that for them, the convenience isn't there. They still have to go to a polling place in order to, for example, if you're visually impaired, you'd still have to go in. But we don't know yet. We collected over 1,000 surveys. So I had a team of students from Menlo College collecting data, both exit polls at the polling universal polling places, and then for a week after the election, we did phone calls and surveyed people. And so we're still cleaning up the data, and I don't have any analysis ready yet, but it's an enormous amount of data, and hopefully we'll see, you know, that the qualitative data matches the quantitative data. That not only was it, you know, less expensive and increased turnout and increased participation in these low propensity groups, but that people liked it. Right? And we did, you know, I was eavesdropping the whole time when the students are doing the surveys, and so I could kind of hear what people are saying, and I think mostly people liked it. Right?
Have you studied at all, and if the answer is no, that's fine, but if you've studied at all, what this has done to the campaigns? Kevin and I have talked more than once about, you know, the campaign is now, the election day is now 30 days long, mm-hmm. and that changes all the strategy of the campaigns. Kevin was vigorously worrying about if you're walking door to door and you're going to high propensity voters, how do you pass the door of a place where you know there's a ballot inside? And you just, if you knocked on the door and convinced them to vote, then they'd be a voter too. So have you studied at all this whole, how this affects the campaigns and how that's changing the nature of our politics?
Yeah, no, that's not what I do. I look at turnout, not really about you know, campaigning or vote
certainly
choice.
Turnout will affect the nature of the outcomes as well, won't it?
Well, yes, if you increase turnout, especially among groups that tend Democratic, you are likely to see changes in the results.
Now, correct me if I'm wrong, I believe you're going to be communicating with some of the city council and elected folks. Mm-hmm. I would love to see, just to your point, even if it's sort of informally, if the candidates themselves were communicating to and walking to homes that aren't the high propensity voters, the sort of mid propensity, or they vote in presidential but they don't bother with local. But this may be the first time a city council candidate communicated with them, because normally those are poll voters on presidential, you walk by those homes. So you can get down to sort of the granular level here, but I think there were a variety of triggers that brought more people in to the democratic process in a municipal election, and I'd love to sort of dig into to those. So those are interesting questions, and maybe we can capture that in 2017. On that point, though, just about 2017, in 2016, a presidential year, we're now going to be going back to the traditional model. Even though we have more permanent absentee voters, we're going back to the traditional model and then toggling back to the all vote by mail process in 2017. So I think that points to the need to do ongoing communication with the voter pool about how these things are conducted year to year.
Will there be, I mean, we have more mail-in voters than we did before, more permanent absentees. Mm-hmm. Is that going to be, you know, is there a hangover? Is there an impact that this election is going to have on the next election?
Yes, there's a habit formation effect, basically, that once somebody is voting, and especially once they're a permanent vote-by-mail voter, they are more likely to participate. And we do know, as a community of scholars, we do know that when people are registered as permanent vote-by-mail, campaigns, you know, they see that, and so they reach out to them because they know that those folks are more likely to vote. And so the communication, the promotional aspect is still there.
We're going to take another break. The community of scholars probably doesn't include Kevin and me, but with that caveat, we'll hope you'll stick around and join us for the next part of the show. Stick around.
It's been over 150 years since Wells Fargo first opened for business. Since then, we've enjoyed your community support, and we're passionate about returning it. Every day, Wells Fargo team members roll up their sleeves and donate their time to organizations and charitable groups throughout the Bay Area. Nationally, we've committed even more. In just the past 2 years alone, we've donated over $70 million to support schools and educational programs. It's a commitment we're proud of. Wells Fargo, the next stage.
my Mark Simon, Kevin Mullen, over here, Professor Melissa Michelson from Menlo College. We were talking off the air just a minute ago about, we're all sort of, Kevin and I are bowled over by the turnout among younger voters, because the historic knock on them is that if it's a local election, they don't care. It means nothing to them. And that there's a sort of a general sweeping view. Everybody knows about and cares about national elections. Nobody cares about local elections, which always seems backwards, because local elections are the ones where you can have the most influence. But this puts the lie to that, really, doesn't it? That it's more a matter of they're not disengaged. They just hadn't been engaged by
others.
They
hadn't been reached out to, and we were making it inconvenient. So now everything's going right. They're getting postcards reminding them that the election's coming up. The ballot's coming to their mailbox. The universal polling places are there. So we made it easier, and we advertised it. And for young people, that's what it takes. And that actually is consistent with scholarship. It's not that they don't care. It's that they, you know, they have a lot of stuff going on,
yeah.
And they just need a little shove.
So those older folks, we don't have as much going on. We have a very quiet life. there are a lot of people who think there's a lot of room for improvement, and that maybe we got lucky that the turnout went up, because there are anecdotal stories about universal polling places that weren't sufficiently advertised, people going to traditional polling places and not getting adequate information about where they should have gone, not getting that information ahead of time. I know a lot of people were concerned that, in fact, as much outreach as there was, that there wasn't enough and it should have happened sooner. You have any feel for that?
Yeah, there were definitely some problems, and unfortunately, to add to that, there was a problem of some people mailing their ballot back and the post office mistakenly delivering it back to the voter, which
there's
caused...
I've heard about this as well, and I believe it was the placement of the return address that actually was mistaken if
exactly.
The ballot was turned around. So ballot design, all those things.
The envelope design
need to be looked
perhaps
at.
Perhaps needs to be tweaked. Or the post office just needs a little bit more training to say, like, hey, these are going to be coming, and you know, don't send them to the voters. The great thing about this extended pilot is that we have another chance in 2017, right? And so the elections office can say, okay, we had this problem with the envelopes, we had trouble with people maybe not getting all the information they needed, let's do it again. Mm-hmm. And of course, that will also satisfy the critics who say, oh, well, sure, turnout was increased, it's a novelty effect, but it won't persist because the novelty will be gone next time. So
if you were gonna recommend some things that needed to be done differently, what would it be, other than the envelope? I mean, was there enough communication, or should there have been more?
I think that the more the elections office can do to publicize that an election is coming up and to encourage people to participate, the better. Mm-hmm. Because study after study shows that that really increases turnout. So regardless of the degree to which people felt it wasn't done enough or things went wrong, if the elections office does more promoting, more mobilizing, instead of leaving it to the candidates and, you know, maybe the political parties who, you know, that comes across in a different way, right? If the elections office says to you, I want you to vote, that's a very different message than a candidate saying, vote for me, right? And so if the elections office can do more of that, I'm always all for that. And we know from the scholarship that that has huge effects. These postcards are huge in terms of getting people to vote.
So do you think we've stepped off now and that we're not turning back from this? Do you think that the vote by mail is just going to become, at some point or another, it's inevitable that we're going to be doing that? Or we may even skip right past it and go to vote by iPhone?
Well, I think a lot of people would like us to find a way to make everyone comfortable with voting by phone. If we can do our banking by phone, if we can run a lot of our lives by phone, why not voting? And so if there's a way to make that secure, that people aren't concerned about election fraud, that, right, we need to get those Silicon Valley minds on that project, because I think mail is not the wave of the future.
You know? Right.
That's an old technology, and although it's definitely better than voting in person in terms of convenience and cost and all those things, I don't think that's really the inevitable ending point.
Yeah, mail is probably that transition to the iPhone eventually. The question is, what is that timeline and security and all that? It's probably a question for another show, but it strikes me that you could lower every barrier in the world, make it as easy as possible. There's still a disconnect. People, you know, there were still 70% of the voters in this election who didn't participate.
Sure.
As much as we're sort of celebrating that increase. and we only have 1 minute, so there's no way you'll be able to answer this, but for another show and for your scholarship.
By the way, we will have you back once you have your results of your survey. Thank you for coming.
The other measures that affect turnout, the feeling of, you know, my one vote doesn't count against all the special interest money and the prevalence of super PACs. And you deal with young people. I'm sure you engage with them on a regular basis about those bigger questions beyond convenience of voting, attitudes about their civic participation. And again, too big a topic to address right now, but we'd love to have you back to really get into those other more difficult questions, frankly.
Sure. I could talk about those things.
Good.
Another day.
And we'll do that on another day, but we're out of time for today. Professor Melissa Michelson from Menlo College, thank you so much for being with us. And thank you for being with us. I'm Mark Simon.
And I'm Kevin Mullen.
And join us next time on The Game.